Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. Today we're going to continue on with this week's theme of studio versus live, checking out a studio recording, analyzing what the music is doing and exploring the themes of it, and then checking out a live performance to compare and contrast it against. Today we're going to be looking at Tool's Push It off of their 1996 Anima album. Let's just dive straight into this and see what Tool is bringing to the table today. We have a 6-beat phrase to kick the song off. We have a polyrhythm going on, and that the drums are still in an 8-bar phrase. So the snare, we have accent on 1, bass kick on 3, but our guitar is still working in a 6-beat phrase. The drums have moved up to the 3 now, getting a snare on 1 and 4. Or is it a 4? The last section could be felt in 5 too. They're playing around a lot with phrasing. Atmospherically, it's very sparse, quiet. Even this utilizes a lot of space between the notes. Love the ride cymbal work here, keeping the song pushing forward, lots of energy. Finally getting that full sound here. Tons of bass presence, love that. Thank you. I mentioned the five earlier in our post-first chorus. I'm not too sure about it. I've been looking elsewhere for the five as well, and I think I misheard that, because the five isn't appearing anywhere else. Though I suppose it would be very Tool to utilize a phrasing just for eight bars and then never touch it again, so that's something I have to go back and listen for. I like how the vocal line, we're gonna hear it again. It's the two emphasized notes on the bass. Ba-dup, 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 ba-dup. There's actually three notes on the bass, but Maynard lines up on just the two key ones to create this nice syncopated rhythm. Ba-dup, ba-dup, ba-o. Yeah. Really nice way of adapting the bass line to his melody. Bringing that ride cymbal back. Still going with the narrower guitar though. Texture and atmosphere to let the drums open up. What? We entered into a new key? There's that full guitar sounds. A lot of note choices in there I would not have expected though. There's that same rhythmic pattern we had in the buildup that was on the vocals. Nice callback. We'll be right back. Interesting final note there. Harmonically, it's exactly probably where I would have taken it. It's a great way to provide resolution to the progression they had been playing around with, but production-wise, everything up to that point had punch and impact and width, and the final note doesn't. Or it kind of does on the very initial impact, the very initial attack of the instruments, but it's immediately pulled back, and it kind of makes the ending feel a bit weak. Maybe that's intentional. I mean, I'm not throwing shade at the decision there. It's quite possible that this song is about something that thematically ties into that concept of pulling energy away or something like that. I don't know. It's not the only time in the track that I feel like we could have had a wider, full-bodied sound and didn't get it. And it does make the song feel a bit of a letdown there. And at the very end, the very last moment, there's one step left to finish the race and they tripped. And again, that's not a negative thing. It could be something they're trying to emphasize through the lyrics and the music. It is an interesting way to end the track, missing a bit of context though. Let's start with metric stuff. I think that's the most interesting part of the track, at least the first interesting thing that I picked up on. The song starts off in a nice 6-4 that I kind of find out later is more of a 6-8. Regardless, we have a 6-beat phrase, or a 6-note phrase, I should say. It eventually gives way to it. Oh, that was on guitar, right? And it eventually gives way for the drums to join in, but the drums are out of phase. They're working with an 8-beat phrase, in which that when the guitars reach beat 7, they're starting their idea over again, since it's only 6 beats long, and the drums are still on beat 7 and then 8 of their idea, and when they start over, when they hit their new beat 1, we're on beat 3 of the guitar line. And so you see they get out of sync with each other. Eventually, they will line back up. But it takes a while. A long while. It creates a very interesting polymetric feeling throughout here, where you have two ideas with different phrases to them and thus different time signatures, which is why we have polymetric, more than 1 meter. Meter is another word for time signature, in which the ideas that you hear, the loops that you hear, don't all loop and repeat at the same time. It creates tons of layers. Here we only have 2 layers, the guitar and the drums, but it's still a really neat way to bring the track in. I know Tool does metric stuff. They are very much on the forefront of the modern prog metal sound in my mind, shifting from the classic prog sound of dealing with things sonically and atmospherically, being progressive in sounds, to more the modern way of being progressive with composition, which is typically metric and harmonics. Tool tends to play more with the metric stuff, sticking with more of an alt-rock sound harmonically in general. This song very much exemplifies that. It is metrically interesting. It is structurally interesting. Structurally, it's common. A, B, A, B, C, B. We do have a little bit of variation at the end after we exit our bridge. And the bridge does have a couple of unique microsections, if you want to call them that. So it isn't a perfect A, B, A, B, C, B, but it does follow that baseline structure and has a couple variations towards the end of it. And like I said, harmonically we sit around the alternative rock sound in general. So they're not playing with anything there, creating, you know, jazzier sounds or playing with classical sounds or anything like that. Very much a modern 90s rock sound. So the metrics is where they chose to be progressive on this track. And it shows right from the start. As soon as I figured, oh, we're in six, I got thrown a wrench just immediately. I mean, they wasted no time on that. What's interesting then is not just that they stick with this polyrhythm, which they could have easily done that, but they find ways for both sides to expand and contrast. Expand and shrink. There we go. Their lines in order to better fit the other time. So while we do have an 8-beat drum phrase, we do eventually hear a 6-beat variant of it. And while the guitars do have a 6-beat phrase, we do hear an 8-beat variant of it later. So that if they want, they can be out of sync and do the polyrhythmic thing, but if they want them to be lined up, they have ideas for both the 6 and the 8 versions of the idea, of the section. In order for the song to fluidly move between either of them, it is a really great way to write because it allows the song to move in any direction you want. You can keep up the polyrhythmic stuff, or you can make it easier to groove along to, and you don't have to pick and choose one side or the other. You can create contrast by doing the six and doing that for a little bit, and then moving to the eight and doing that for a little bit, and then going for the split poly thing again. It opens up a lot of avenues, not just for interesting sections, but for a section to metamorphosize between multiple various states. All of it seemingly intertwined and connected. There isn't any disjointed element to it because the phrases themselves, whether you choose the six or the eight, or even the poly in that first bar, at least in the first six beats, they're all going to sound the same for at least six beats. So the difference is going to be when we hit beat seven. What happens? Are we repeating the loop? Are we continuing for two more beats? Or are we separating here and realizing we went to the poly? And so you can change it almost whenever you want, completely under the radar. Up until beat seven, of course, and that's when the listener is going to realize, oh, that felt a bit odd. I wasn't expecting that, and that's because you've changed up from the six to the eight or something like that. Just a really great way to explore this, but they expand upon this even more, and several of the future sections, especially in the bridge, predominantly have variations of the six and the eight, and we hear movement back and forth between both of them, not in the same manner as our verse, which sort of has this this fluid movement between them all, but we hear six and eight phrases in the bridge. Basically, they put the legwork in at the beginning to establish, hey, you could hear any of this in the future, so that when we do, we're like, oh, that's normal. That's what I'm expecting. They've already told me to expect this. It allows them not only the freedom in the verse to manipulate it how they like, but to write pretty much whatever they want in the future as long as they're working within the six or eight framework, and for it not to feel disjointed or new or disconnected from the song at large. It gives them a lot of freedom moving forward. It also allows the song to enter into two feels. Straight quarter note feel or triplet feel. The triplet feel is going to come from the six. If we write out the 6-8 line in 4-4, we get a triplet feel. So you can either feel them as 1-2-3-4-5-6, 1-2-3-4-5-6, a bit straighter, or if you listen to it in the four, triplet, 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 and you can hear these groups of three against the backbeat of four. So not only does it give them the freedom of phrasing, it also gives them the freedom of rhythmic feel. And that rhythmic feel can come through in a different way, in a few different ways. We do hear the traditional triplet feel of emphasizing beat one and four. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. Kind of giving it a little bit of a waltzy idea, although they tend to swing and change up the syncopation of them a little bit, which kind of removes that swung feel a little bit. But we also hear an interesting idea in the bridge that I pointed out on the bass, which is 1-2-3-4-5-6. Man, that is hard to do. Emphasizing 1-3-4-6, de-emphasizing 2 and 5. My brain does not want to do that fast, though. And so you get the bass that's playing all six notes, well, groupings of three, I suppose, And then you get the vocals on top of that, just emphasizing one and three, which kind of comes through as just regular old eighth notes. Perceived, anyways, not technically, mathematically. And so once again, freedom to do expanded ideas within this framework that they've already laid down. It's why the song, despite exploring so many different rhythmic feels, continues to feel cohesive throughout the journey. They set a lot of groundwork in the very beginning in order to have a ton of branches in front of them to go wherever they want. Just really great writing, rhythmically, and introducing ideas like that. Now, with that said, I am going to move into a little bit of criticism here. If you consider yourself a Tool hyper fan, you picture yourself in part of the Tool army or whatever, maybe this is the time to duck out before you get too mad because someone on the internet has an opinion. I do want to go into this section reminding people that Tool are humans, and they are humans who created art. Humans are flawed, thus their art is flawed. That is how all art exists. On top of that, I'm just some guy on the internet. I'm not up here trying to spout facts about this song. I'm simply telling observations I've made that have a little bit of mix with my own biases and opinions about music in general. I'm not some musical authority. If you want to look at me as such, go ahead and leave your nasty comments down there, whatever. It's engagement for me. It makes the channel more popular in the algorithm. Go for it. That's the cynical take for the day. The bad comments give me exposure. Oh, man. Maybe I should edit that out. I don't edit, so whatever. Let's keep going forward. I'm not a big fan of the production on this. Here's the thing. The song starts out lacking punch, which is perfectly fine. A great way to build up intensity in a track is to craft a smaller section and juxtapose it with a larger section, and we actually do that in this track. Around the 3.5 minute mark, we reach a point where it's just massive, huge sound. Great way to build into that energy and that feeling. We get there by kind of having everything feel a bit anemic. The guitars, the bass, the drums, the vocals, they're all just a bit small, like they're caged up in a box, and we're listening to that, where their sounds are purposefully restricted. And around the 3 minute mark, we open that up and the song really reaches a full width and impact. There's punch to all of the sounds. I thought from this point on, we would have stuck with that. Honestly, this is a big moment that probably would have worked better in the middle or the end of a song, but given it was the beginning, I looked at the first minute or the first 2 minutes or so as an introduction. It is a 10 minute song after all, and a 2 minute introduction on a prog track is really not that far out of place. It wasn't long before we went back to the restrained sound. The song really likes to sit in this state, not the other. Speaking of states, this is the second time in two topics I've brought it up. Is this track about states of whatever, states of being, states of mind, states of personality? I mean, Tool likes to make seemingly profound lyrics and talk about things that seem really deep. That sounds like a topic they would certainly talk about. So we'll get into the lyrics later, though. I mean, that's the structure of the format. We dig into the music, we check out the lyrics. But that seems like something they would do, and it seems purpose-built that this song fluctuates between states as it does. Anyways, we go back to the anemic sound for quite some time, though, until the very end of the track. We have two build-ups, so to speak, into the unleashed sound, and it just never really feels right. Maybe it works thematically or artistically to be constrained for so much of the song, but it never quite reaches a point of enjoyment for me as a listener because of that. And, you know, I enjoy music for multiple reasons. it may not connect with me casually, where I enjoy listening to it, but it might connect with me artistically, in which case, I have an appreciation for what they're doing, even if I'm not a big fan of what it is. Until we get into the lyrics, I don't know if I'm going, I don't know if this is one that I would enjoy artistically, but sonically, I always found it to be a bit of a letdown. Much like I talked about there at the end, even the final note, which should have a bit of impact, was immediately removed like a gut punch. The song just never really clicks for me sonically. Which is a shame because, musically I had a lot of praise for it. Even aside from the metric stuff, during the reaction, we talked about callbacks, we talked about variation. During the metrics part, I talked about how we have the structure. It takes the traditional verse chorus, bridge chorus structure and puts a nice little twist on it. Our bridge is actually a couple of sections altogether, and our outro is also a little bit of some of our chorus, but a variation on it. Also, utilizing ideas that we expressed first in the bridge. It's a double callback, if you will, but a variation on both of those. There's a lot of really great stuff on paper. The execution just never clicks for me. And so, much like a lot of other tool that we've checked out, I can see why they have a fan base. I can see why people really enjoy their music. And I kind of want to enjoy them in that same way, but there's always just something that gets in the way. Fortunately for this track, it doesn't have the same problem that Numa had. I think it was called Numa. The first single, I think, off of Fear Inoculum. I think that's what it was called. It's been a long time since we checked that out. At least, what, 2 years now? Anyways, that song just sort of did nothing for a long time in the middle. They have their build-ups. That's like the Tool formula right there is alternative rock first chorus, and then a slow burn bridge, and then alternative rock. Verse chorus outro. And this song follows along with that just well. It's what I enjoyed though is that the build up wasn't meandering. I actually enjoyed the build up here. We explored some new sounds. It started out a bit slow, built into it, added layers, but the layers I found were interesting this time around, more so than Numa, at least on a first listen. More of a surface level enjoyment, I suppose you'd call it. Though even after three listens, Numa's bridge still hasn't clicked with me. And I saw a few fans of Tool also not a big fan of Numa's bridge as well. So I'm not alone in it, even within the fandom. But again, that doesn't make it an authoritative take either. It's still just my opinion. Regardless, we explored new ideas, we introduced new layers, we replaced layers, we did some call and response, we did some passing of the baton. There was some awesome stuff that kept my interest throughout the entire bridge while building into what I found to be a really interesting guitar solo, or at least a lead guitar section. It was just tremolo picking with some fuzzy effects on it. So you can call it a solo if you'd like. It lacked the melody that I tend to require in putting that label on something. But it introduced notes that were outside of the key they had been playing within. Now, granted, they were playing in a stripped down key. As far as I could tell, it was generally a pentatonic scale, which is five notes. It's missing a few to be a full key. And maybe the extra notes that they finally filled out the key were just not what I was expecting. It gave it a brighter classic rock vibe rather than the 90s alt rock thing that they typically play within. It lacked a bit of the darkness that I associate with Tool for just a brighter, more optimistic sound in general, but still paired with the wall of sound buildup that I associate with them. It's not wrong, of course. It's just very surprising, and not only does it go against my idea of Tool as a whole, which is typically good. I like when bands challenge themselves, but it kind of goes against everything else in the song. Once again, a secondary state to the track, this one being the emotional aspect of the atmosphere. It is explored for such a short amount of time, a blink and you miss it kind of feeling. 8 bars, 16 bars, maybe tops, and then we never revisit it again. Moving back to the darker pentatonic stuff that we explored in the beginning of the track. I'm really curious what the decision was to utilize those intervals in that guitar lead. It was a very confusing section for me that is probably the least cohesive part of the track, but interesting. And I'll take interesting over meandering any day, even if it doesn't quite click with me. Listening to this, and having listened to a couple of older Tool tracks, well, actually, I listened to them a long time ago, but I didn't realize they were Tool until people told me about them. But I do think I like older Tool better than newer Tool. I do think I need to start with an older album of theirs, preferably one that moves closer to the rock side of things than their prog rock stuff that they tend to do sometimes. I like their, I guess you can call them simpler tracks. I still don't think they're simple, but they're just more surface level enjoyable. They seem to, I think, pander. Oh, not pander. You know what it is? It feels like they have an image of themselves that they feel they have to strive for their fans. Maybe that's not true. That's kind of the feeling I got with Fear Inoculum, though, is that they're put on such a pedestal that they can't do anything less than extreme. And I really wish they could just relax a little bit. I just want to hear what they would make in 6 months instead of 6 years. That might be a real hot take for Tool, though. Let's check out some lyrics. All right. So, lyrically, this seems to be about a divide between two entities, people, whatever. On the surface, it seems to be about the negativity between the two, but an unrelenting positivity as well, or at least a neutral element. That is to say, it could be about a toxic relationship between two things. It could be, the id and the self. It could be between two people. When it comes to Tool, you never know. It could very well just be a breakup song. At the very beginning, it says, "I saw the gap again today while you were begging me to stay. I see the distance between us, even though you tell me I shouldn't be drifting away," right? The chorus says, "But you're pushing and shoving me. You still love me, but you didn't need to push it on me." Being loved aggressively. Kind of sounds cute when you put it that way, but I kind of take it to be more of a toxic relationship where the love is more of a surface level idea and the control is what's hiding underneath it. Verse 2 speaks of wanting to get out. You can rest your trigger on my finger, bang my head upon the fault line. If you want, you can give me an out on this. That kind of idea. The bridge enters into, I think, the main thing here. I'm somewhere I don't want to be. You put me somewhere I don't want to be. Seeing places I don't want to see. This relationship isn't healthy for me. And you continue to make it toxic. That kind of idea. By the end of it says there's no love in fear. I'm staring down the hole again. Hands around my back again. Survival is my only friend. Terrified of what may come. Remember, I'll always love you as I claw your throat away. It will end no other way. The use of again frequently throughout this album tells me that this is not a first time this has happened. Many, many times. And the idea of staring down a hole, maybe even as I perceive it, a bottomless hole, just to be stuck in this purgatory of this relationship. The only way out of it, as he says, survival is what is my only friend here, is to kill you. He states it will end no other way than as I claw your throat away. But remember, as I do that, I'll always love you. And there's a lot of opposing ideas here. To be in a relationship that is not good for you, but for you to still love that person regardless. And again, this is very easy, I think, to read in a traditional relationship between two people, but I think it's easy to read it also in a relationship with yourself. Maybe the moving on of old ideals or habits that you have, somebody who you used to be, who you feel is dragging you down, and you might still really kind of love who you were at one time, but you realize that you can't be that way anymore. You have to move on, grow up, and do other things. Maybe there's a toxic element of your personality that you need to claw its throat out. It's sort of killing a part of yourself, and that's never fun either, but you have to do it. It's the only way it ends. Otherwise, it keeps dragging you down. I've never known Tool to write songs about personal relationships. Maybe they do often. Again, my experience with them is quite limited. Only like 7 or 8 tracks now. But they tend to be a bit more cerebral about the self and the mind, more so than being in relationships with people. Although now that I think about it, Maynard has sung about his mom on multiple occasions too. So there are personal anecdotes and stories in both Tool and Perfect Circle, as we saw with Judith a while ago. So maybe he does sing about relationships with people. I don't know. It doesn't seem very Tool-like to me. It's borderline breakup song. It seems like something that I would expect in post-hardcore, metalcore, or even emo to an extent. It's just being stuck in a bad relationship. That's not really Tool's MO in my mind. So like I said, I kind of think my mind wants to put more of a cerebral spin on it. That's just how I perceive Tool, though. So with all that said, I suppose it's time to dive into the salival version of this, which is a live version. And without further ado, let's dive in.
We've been trying something a little different this tour. We've been looking at one of our songs from a different angle, under a different light.
Okay, this is fun.
See it almost for the first time. We'd like to try that for you tonight. Is that okay? We're gonna need your help, though. We need your help and your permission. So we need you to find a comfortable space that's not only comfortable but vulnerable. I want you to shut your eyes and go there, and we'll meet you on the other side. Thank you.
So the three is still present, but it's a very different riff. I mean, even right there, that line is brand new. I'm gonna have to look at a separate set of lyrics for this, aren't I? Might be one of the only cases this whole week where I have to do that. Here I was expecting it to be mostly the same track, but with an expanded bridge, which seems up Tool's alley, but a complete reimagination was nowhere even on my bingo card. How late was this in their career too? Because the use of this expanded percussion is something that I associate with them around 10,000 Days. Repeat of that motif. So it's interesting. Here we have a hemiola. In our previous track, our polymetric idea was 3 against 4, but here it's 3 against 2. Yeah. even here in our 4-4 section, it's broken up into groupings of 3-3-2. Not really ever wanting to fully embrace the 4 like we did last time. Having use of reverb too, it definitely feels like they reimagined Push It as something that would fit on 10,000 Days. Massive sound right there. So, despite all the other liberties they took with reimagining this, they kept a majority of this bridge.
Back at the mid
Well, that's two for two with this theme where I like the studio better. And I suppose that's typical. We actually talked about this on the live stream back on Sunday. I just tend to like studio versions better. Studio sessions are nice too, as I found out. I like studio sessions a lot more than I thought. It kind of mixes the chaotic elements of a live show where anything could happen. You're not trying to create a perfect take, you're just performing, but with the control that a studio version typically has. An audio tree is a fantastic example of really great studio sessions. Tiny desk concerts also. I just tend to enjoy those a lot better than live recordings of massive shows like this, which just never seem to click with me for one reason or another. And usually it is because they're trying something wildly different. Like even Monday with Lepers, I don't know that they were necessarily intending to do something different, but they walked away with a very different feeling for the song that I feel didn't work. And here, that's not the case. I feel like what they went for is probably fine. I'm gonna be honest, I'm real interested to get into the lyrics, which is not usually what I want to do immediately after listening to music. I want to ingest it and feel it and figure out what they're doing and then kind of get the cheat sheet, be told directly these are the themes of the song, at least lyrically. But here I want to get right into it because the beginning of the track emphasized a very different take on it, and even the preamble to the track introduced the concept of perspective shift. What if it's not you that's toxic? What if it's me that created a toxic environment that created you? Or at least that's what I got from the few lines that I heard at the beginning. By the end of the track, the dude was singing like Seal, and even knowing the words he was singing, I could barely make out any enunciated syllables. It was all just kind of slurred together. And there was no way I was going to pick up any lyrics in the more bombastic sections. Not a dig at Maynard. For all I know, this was at the very end of a performance. The dude was getting winded, and sometimes technique goes out the window a little bit for a more emotive performance. And I will say that the performance was solid, even if each syllable wasn't perfectly enunciated. So there's a lot of factors that go into that. Again, I'm not throwing shade at him, but it was very difficult to make out words in that final section. And I was, as I recognized the bridge was identical and moving to our closing, our outro was identical musically, I was really interested if the lyrics changed and I could not make them out. And I thought that was interesting. Now, leading up to the bridge, though, the song musically enters into a few different ideas. Mostly, they completely recontextualized and revisited the ambient, quieter, introspective moments of the song with new instrumentation. That being that our guitars have a different timbre this time around, a different guitar tone for a more metal phrase for that. We have different instrumentation in the percussion. We have an expanded percussion set. Not only do we probably have an expanded drum kit, I know that the drummer likes like a bajillion things on his drum kit these days. Again, I don't know when this takes place. I kind of put the sound around 10,000 Days era. I guess I'll have to check that out later. It looks like it came out at least 2010, maybe before that, but definitely pre Fear Inoculum. Inoculum? Probably should have looked up the name of that stupid app. Oh, man. Anyways. You'd think I could easily find it here. Anyways, definitely predates that, and it probably is around the time of 10,000 Days. Because sonically, it's very similar as far as the instrumentation, the voicings that they select, and we hear a lot of this expansion influence the music as well. It's not just here's some different sounds that we've been playing with. Here's our new guitar tone rather than our older one. It's these new sounds have influenced my relationship to the song, so we're going to change the song as well. That's kind of the feeling I get from the band. And the song ends up being a bit more introspective. There's a lot less angst in it. Sonically, it's more somber, actually. It feels more like grief rather than anger. The studio version feels very much like, you are making my life hell and I would like to get out even if one of us has to die. Very angry. And this one, at least not knowing what the lyrical changes are yet, feels more like, it sucks that this relationship isn't great and one of us is going to have to get really hurt in order for me to be happy. And I hate that. And that sort of somber dealing with this depression about the end of this relationship or the possible end of this relationship in a messy way is what the song tells me now. And I think that sort of transition certainly comes about through a maturity, not just emotional maturity of being able to recontextualize this relationship, whether it's real or fictional, being able to see it from a new perspective, but also a musical maturity, growing as musicians and composers and finding new ways to write. Unfortunately, I'm not too sure that both of these sides married together too well. I appreciate the expanded ideas in here. I appreciate certainly the expanded atmosphere in our opening, the opening of the track. I think the somber atmosphere certainly fits the empty hollowness of the first one in a way that expands upon and further deepens the emotional resonance of the introduction of the track. It really isn't until about the 4-minute mark when we begin to reach into the bridge sections that I feel the song sort of falls apart a little bit, cohesively. The beginning of the track enters in with some finger drums with a really high pitch to them. A bunch of auxiliary percussion. We have like a teardrop sounding thing going on. And some string instruments that aren't an electric guitar. I couldn't tell you exactly what they're utilizing. But it's neat timbres all in all. I don't have a problem with these sounds at all. In fact, I'm happy to be here for the contrasting and variable sound that they're utilizing. I just don't know that it works for the song itself. The cohesion takes a step back in order to create a 2.5-minute meandering piece that feels more at home with their newer stuff than their older stuff. And while this song certainly acts as a bridge between the two eras, musically, it doesn't really lend itself well to this moment. I really feel like this extended bridge didn't add anything to the track and in fact felt like a hurdle. It introduced friction to the track. Now, that divide, that division could be interpreted as the gap between the two. And putting a harsher schism between these two sides certainly works well at showcasing the gap between our two characters or two mindsets, or you know, whatever. It's an interesting way to add an artistic element to it, but it doesn't help with the art itself. I think what I'm getting at here is that it's too extreme of a shift. Musically, it sounds like a totally different song altogether. In fact, it feels like something that would have come off of 10,000 Days and not a reimagining of Push It. It lacks some of the sensibilities of the track itself, which, while being different, is still like 70% its original version. And so to make such a harsh deviation both. And I think this is the big thing that makes it an extreme shift, is that it's both harmonic, not harmonically, texturally different by utilizing new timbres, but it's also harmonically and melodically different because it's a brand new section. And so it just feels a bit too far divorced from what the song is doing. And thus it took me out of the moment entirely. On top of that, to bring in some more of a subjective take on it, it meanders. It introduces an extra couple of minutes to the bridge doing everything that I hate that modern Tool does. And it feels noodly. It doesn't add anything to the track. It doesn't create an emotional value. We already have a build-up, so it's not like we needed the extra build-up. The original did the build-up just fine. Expand on that idea. Don't expand on a brand new idea to get into that idea, because now it just feels like it's too long. If something should have been left on the cutting room floor, and for my take, it's what was added for this version. Beyond that, though, the end of the track seems to move in exactly the same area. The guitar solo was fairly identical, our outro was fairly identical. It really is the beginning and the bridge that we deviated upon, and possibly some lyrics as well. And for the most part, I do feel like they're beneficial. It shows a maturation of the band in a way that I think improves the track, at least up until that bridge. And, you know, the bridge is always the part I have. It's my biggest contention with modern Tool. So I guess it comes to no surprise that I wasn't a big fan of this bridge either. I'm going to take a second to hit some lyrics, and then we're going to wrap this one up. Just a quick note, there aren't too many changes to this. However, there is multiple instances of recognizing the eye. The main character, the perspective we get in this track, also contributing to the issues. As I alluded to earlier in the analysis, the intro is expanded to say that I've managed to push myself away and you as well. The chorus has changed from, and you're pushing and you're shoving, you still love me, but you don't need to push it on me. All of it to you doing it, to you're pushing and we're shoving and we're pushing and I'm shoving. The idea that we're all kind of in this together. Neither one of us has clean hands in the issues of our relationship. It feels less like a toxic relationship, as the first one states, and more of just not a great one. Maybe the two people are fine together, but they're not great. It's almost as if the relationship is in a bit of a, I wouldn't say a rut, it just isn't healthy for the two of them anymore. They're not actively trying to bring each other down, but it's sort of just a byproduct of being around each other. And by the end of it, it's the same as always. If I stay here, then I'll disappear. The only other way is if I claw your throat away. There's no other way. We're going to get hurt out of this. Like I said, it kind of matches the somber elements of it. It's not angry. It's not wrathful. It's just sort of sad. This isn't the way it should be. We don't have any other options. And that kind of sucks. I do want to state a couple of things I forgot to bring up at the end of the last lyrical dive. I mentioned that in the studio version, the ending note is a bit lackluster, and I think it kind of is supposed to be, especially in light of the re-envisioned take on this track. It's not supposed to be super cathartic. It's not supposed to be this punctuation at the end of an experience. It's sort of just the end of something. The closing lyrics say that I love you, but I will rip your throat out because it's what I have to do. And in the first track, despite it being angry, the lyrics speak regret. It can end no other way. I don't have a choice in this. This isn't what I want to do. It's what I have to do. And despite doing it, I will always love you. There is conflict, inner conflict here. And so assuming that the end of the track is clawing his way out, killing the other person metaphorically in order to free himself, it's not going to feel good. There's going to be a quick moment of release and relief, and that is the initial hit. But that wideness is immediately removed for kind of a lackluster final note. And I think that's supposed to reflect the feeling of this, that immediate sigh of relief followed by the regret, the sorrow, the sadness. And I think that's what makes the live version an interesting follow-up to that, because it takes that one beat of emotion and goes into a maximalist mentality. What if we explored this one beat for 13 minutes? And I think that's really awesome. I also mentioned that this track is constantly in multiple states, fighting itself, trying to figure out what it wants to do, what it wants to be, and slipping between them. That lines up on multiple levels. We have the love-hate element of the relationship, where there's obviously feelings and want of well-being of the other person, but knowing that the relationship can't continue on if both of these people want to live healthy lives. It has to end, but he doesn't want it to end. That duality right there is present in the music, but also just the gap between these two people, the fact that they can't line back up. They're always on opposition of one another. That lines up really well with the six against four idea that, six against eight, there we go. That we just never really explore too much in the reimagining version, which kind of lines up thematically with it, but I just don't think is as strong of a way of connecting the lyrics and music as the studio version had. I don't want to say the studio version was perfect. I still think the atmosphere of the live version is greatly improved, and lyrically it's a much better direction to go, especially if it takes a more realistic stance on the events, if they really happened. But the division and the polymetric stuff that doesn't ever show up in the live version adds so much to the artistic side of the song that kind of sad they got removed. This is like, it's one of those situations where neither version can be seen as definitive. I think they both have their strengths, they both have their weaknesses, and honestly, I would really love a combination of the two, a third version to finally pull everything together and make the ultimate take on the song. Unfortunately, I don't think the tool of today has the skills to do that. Primarily because they seem to be so detached from who they were back in 96, and they don't seem to have any want or need to go back to them. And so there's a schism within the band that would never allow them to create the midpoint to this track that I would personally want. Those are my thoughts on Tool's Push It. Let me know yours. Did you enjoy one of these, all of these, both of these? Anything that stood out to you, anything you think I was wrong on, or anything you'd like to expand on what I said, your own thoughts, opinions, perspectives, which version did you like better? Above the comment section is a description box. In there is a link for Linktree. It'll take you to this menu right here. You can find links to my music, ways to support the channel, a link to the Discord server, and so much more. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I greatly appreciate all three of those. That wraps it up for today. I'll be back tomorrow, though, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. UTC, as usual. We're going to check out a special selection tomorrow, as well as sounds from my inbox, something we haven't done in a while. Check out four songs from four up-and-coming bands, usually on the smaller side, low amounts of Spotify listens and subscribers, giving them a little bit of a spotlight and some feedback, a little bit of criticism and analysis. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.